Asian stocks off to a strong start thanks to tailwind from Wall Street, which closed at its highest in a month. Last Friday, amid easing inflation expectations, U.S. stocks, of course, were closed on Monday, but futures are looking mixed. Here at home, the PSEI extended its rally, jumping another 1.4% after entering bull market last week. The PSE index settling at 1745 on the back of net foreign buying to the tune of 1.1 billion pesos. We want to bring in Jing Candelaria of AIA Philippines for his take. Hi, Jing. Good to see you.
If it's not too late, Mimi, I want to greet you a prosperous new year.
Ah, it's actually early. We are waiting for Chinese New Year, but Happy New Year. So far, this year is looking pretty good. I mean, judging from the first 3 weeks of 2023, we're back above 7,000. The index is up 7.5% in just the first 3 weeks. And week three is not even done yet. Is this a little too much too soon, Jing?
We're actually approaching 2023 with optimism, but at the same time, cautiousness, especially with what happened last year, which is a very volatile year where the index had a range from 5,740, it's rough, to as much as 7,500. This year would still be the same. It's going to be volatile. Therefore, to answer your question, I think the run-up of 7.5%, and you may add the run-up from the fourth quarter, which boils about 22% already, is quite too soon. I think the market for 2023 will have two halves. First will be quite a difficult market where interest rates are still expected to go up in the U.S., which is the focal point of global interest rates, which is still not supportive of risk assets. The target for inflation for the U.S., as we know, is 2%. We're about 6.5%, and so more interest hikes are expected, although the signaling is that it's going to be tempered, and therefore what's going to happen is there will be a protracted period of interest rate hike still, which I think will create a lot of volatility, and therefore this first leg we're looking at around 6,000 to even 7,000. Therefore at the moment I'm seeing quite a toppish level already. Now the second leg will be after the inflection point, or what we could say the pivot, where the U.S. Fed would say, okay, this is enough. We've done damage already to the U.S. economy. We've brought it down, we've tempered it down. And therefore, it may be time to temper or even reverse our interest rate policy to bring it up. And therefore, that becomes more supportive of risk assets. And we expect this to happen more towards the end of the year, second half of towards the end of the year, where I think that second leg will maybe promote a 7,000 to 7,500 for the BCOM index. So as of the moment, the 7.5%, we just have to be a bit cautious in approaching this with much more optimism.
Mm-hmm. Just very quickly, you did give us the mark for this year, but just to clarify, what is your base case for 2023 for the index?
The base case is 7,000. Actually, admittedly,
we're
more conservative. Yes, and I would say we're there. Of course, it can stretch it up a bit to about 7,500, but 7,500
is the bull case.
6% up is a bull case, and it's nothing at the moment given the very volatile moves of the market.
And so what about
it can happen in 1 month or 2 months' time?
All right. And what about your bear case?
I'm looking at 6,000. So the range that we're looking at is from 6,000 as much as 7,500, which is more or less similar to the range that we had last year of 5,700 to as much as 7,500. Because we're maintaining the same volatility that we expected last year. So we're not yet off the hook yet in terms of volatility in the market.
Mm-hmm. When you've got a range that big, a 1,500 point range, what does that tell you aside from volatility? Does that tell you the market is confused? Does that tell you the market does not know how to feel, or it feels one thing one day, quickly shifts to another feeling the next day? too enthusiastic at one point, too depressed at another. What does that tell us?
Well, last year, the main culprit of the movement of a market are unexpected events. As we all know, Russia-Ukraine happened in February, as well as the aggressive policy moves of the central bank, particularly in the U.S. Now, I think, policies are still not concerted at the moment. I've been hearing that even rate hikes happening in the Western Hemisphere, and then you have Japan already, expanding already their monetary policy. So there's still a mix of policy direction, as well as expectations on the policy movements are still not concerted among investors. And therefore, this drives, volatilities in the market.
All right. Given this expectation, how much cash would you recommend investors to be holding today? And if at all, should they be swayed to put more in maybe fixed income if they don't want the wild swings, or add more to equities if they're into high risk, high return? What's the strategy?
Again, taking off from 2022, the pecking order of assets is that, risk assets and even fixed income assets, there was nowhere to hide. Both of them went down. Risk assets went down. Fixed income went down as interest rates went up. So in terms of pecking order, cash, fixed income, equity. Now going into 2023, we've seen fixed income to be approaching quite attractive levels already. 10-year rates have gone to as much as 7%, maybe at 6.5% at the moment. So money is starting to trickle down from cash more to fixed income, and then a bit going towards equity. As I've mentioned to you, equity or risk asset is still to be taken in quite cautiously for this year.
All right, cautious optimism. Jing, let's go over some interesting corporate stories that we have. We have this just in. CREIT, which is an affiliate of the Megawide Group, confirming reports that its sponsor, Citicore Renewable Energy Corporation, or CREC, is actually considering an IPO in 2023. With the wild swings, are you expecting strong appetite for new names?
Well, I've seen, Opson starting to, or was able to get an approval, and then you have CREIT. We need all of these IPOs. I think there's some betting already on some quarters that, the three-year bear run that we have experienced, 4 billion foreign buying outflows. So the trickles of foreign buying that we are seeing, 20 million for this year, is good enough to dangle some IPO shares to the public.
All right.
And so I think we'll be seeing trickles of IPO already. And this is very much needed by the stock market at the moment.
All right. We're all looking forward to those new names. How about this from yesterday? Big news. Petron is buying back over $22 million worth of securities that are listed in Singapore to try to cut interest expense. How should investors take a news like this?
Well, I'm looking at the financials of Petron. Petron is having a good year. I think in the first 9 months of the year, their income is up 64% at 8.2 billion, and their revenues have doubled to about 630. So they have the arsenal, they have the financial arsenal to buy back their securities. And as I mentioned earlier on, fixed income is starting to be quite attractive already. So they're probably trying to manage their capital expenses or interest expenses by buying these shares at quite a steep price. I checked the news this morning, and they're buying it at 93 to 100, so discount of 7%, and probably wait for interest rates to further go down, and I probably redeploy or reissue again some securities for their working capital expenses.
All right, that makes sense. So how about this? OFW remittances went up by nearly 6% to $2.93 billion in November of last year. Also, we'd like to congratulate accountant lawyer, attorney Dick Dubaladad, who is now Management Association of the Philippines' 75th president. We hope to speak to her soon. Meralco and Aboitiz considering extending their power deal that expires next week. Are you a big believer in energy for 2023? Is this the winning bet for this year?
Well, looking at the forecast for the next 5 to 7 years, we know that the supply and demand situation is more towards demand. We haven't seen much rollout of capacities, and therefore going into a 5-year period, energy is a good bet. Mm-hmm. But of course, we're putting more premium, or we like more companies that are into the REs or renewable energy.
Mm. All right. And Nickel Asia to inject $2.9 billion into RE, just what you mentioned, Jing, Renewable Energy Unit Emerging Power Inc. We've come to the most exciting part of the conversation, the blind item. Talk to us about the stock that you're monitoring closely. Don't tell us. Just describe. What do you have for us?
Well, I've chosen this stock or this company on mm-hmm. two fronts. One is it's a good play on the China economic reopening.
All right.
As well as I mentioned, on the ESG thematics, because it's supplying a certain commodity that's, you know, is very much used for electric motor vehicle batteries, as well as industrial production, particularly stainless steel. This company is the biggest producer of this commodity with a 40% market share. And the country is actually a major, if not the biggest, supplier of this commodity around the world, with our ASEAN neighbor Indonesia banning the exportation of this commodity. Mm-hmm. The company went into renewables also, although it's still a small portion of its revenues, but about 250 megawatts are going to come on stream by 2025. It will be sourced from solar as well as from geothermal. Mm-hmm. In terms of stock price, I think it's trading at 6.8 at the moment. It's an outperformer. Actually, last year it went up by about 9%, bucking the negative 8% drop of the market. And for this year, I think it's already up by about 15 to 17%. Again, bucking the strong run of the market at 7.5%. And looking at the analyst calls on this in Bloomberg, and upside is quite high at more than 30% return that they're looking at.
All right. We're just going to have to guess which stock this is, Jing. Pleasure speaking with you. Thank you so much for joining us.